welcome. We're so glad that you guys are here to worship with us this morning. I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then we'll get into worship. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for bringing us here, and we thank you that we get to worship. Lord, we praise you because we get to worship, because we get to be in relationship with you. We pray that it would be a sweet sound to your ear, and that it would just be the joy of our hearts to come and pour out our worship upon you. Would we not come just to fellowship or just to check it off the list, but would it be a sincere desire to worship you? That the one thing that we would ask for, the one thing that we would seek, is to see you, to behold you, to worship you. So we thank you for the relationship that we get and the worship that we get to bring. Would we just cast off the great things and the not so great things of life, and would we just come to you? Would we behold you and all that you are, Jesus, this morning? Pray that this would be a sweet sound to your ear, Lord. In your name, amen. Do you guys just want to stand?
Wandering into the night and wanting a place to hide this week. This bag of bones, and I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I was not alone. Oh, and he picked me up and turned me around and placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart and changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior. Oh, I thank God. I cannot deny what I've seen. Got no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends. Burden and bitterness, you can't just keep it moving. You ain't welcome here. From now till I walk streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back home. Oh, you picked me up and turned me around and placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart and changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior. Oh, I thank God. I thank God. And how lost another one, I am free. Oh, I am free. Yes, I am free. Hell lost another one, I am free. Oh, I am free. Yes, I am free. Oh, hell lost another one, I am free. Yes, I am free. Oh, I am free. Yeah, hell lost another one, I am free. Oh, I am free. Yes, I am free. Oh, hell lost another one, I am free. Oh, I am free. Yeah.
I thank the Savior because he healed my heart. He changed my name forever free. I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior. I thank God. I thank God. Oh, I thank God. Yes, I thank God. What an honor to be invited to the marriage of the Lamb, to come and worship Him. Celebration, it's the joining of the bride and the son, the two becoming one. All the prophecies fulfilled in a moment, so we say, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of the rolling thunder. Oh, we're filled with wonder as we behold the man with fire in his eyes, the very word of God. Yes, you are worthy of every kingdom, every nation bowing down. We'll crown you with many crowns. Every creed and tribe and tongue is declaring in unity, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of the rolling thunder. Oh, for the marriage of the Lamb is coming. We're getting ready. We're getting ready. And we'll shout till the whole world hears it. And we'll sing till the whole world knows. The King Jesus, you are faithful. He is the blessed hope. Yes, we'll shout till the whole world hears it. We'll sing till the whole world knows. The King Jesus, he is faithful. He is the blessed hope. Oh, we'll shout till the whole world hears it. And we'll sing till the whole world knows. The King Jesus, he is faithful. He is the blessed hope. Yes, King Jesus, you are faithful. You are a blessed hope. getting ready. We're getting ready. We're getting ready for you. We're getting ready. We're getting ready. We're getting ready for you. Like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of the rolling thunder. Oh, hallelujah! Come give Him glory. Oh, for the marriage of the Lamb is coming. Yes, hallelujah! Come give Him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb is coming. We're getting ready. We're getting ready. We're getting ready for you. We're getting ready. We're getting ready. We're getting ready for you. We're getting ready. Getting ready. We're getting ready for you. Hallelujah. Come give Him glory for the marriage of the Lamb is coming. We're getting ready. We're getting ready. Here it is, my alabaster heart. I'm keeping nothing back from who you are. No hidden treasure veiled by key or lock. You're a lifetime worth of worship, and that's only just the start. Yes, here it is, my ever waking day. The minutes, hours, the years of endless praise. For you're worthy far beyond all I can say. There's a lifetime worth of worship in the nuance of your name. So let it rise like incense, my whole life is a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet, and every breath an offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings, the worthy King of Kings. And there it is, your alabaster cross. You're giving all you are for all I'm not. I can't believe that's the kind of King you are. How could I not bring a lifetime worth of worship to you, God? Oh, let it rise, let it rise like incense. My whole life is a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet, and every breath an offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my yours. You can have it all. So let it arise like incense, my whole life as a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet, and every breath an offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings, the worthy King of Kings. You're the worthy King of Kings. It's who you are, Jesus, the worthy King of Kings. So is it a fragrance that I'll pour my oil out? Is it a life laid down? Then here I give my vows. Is it a song I sing? Then here's every melody. Just tell me what moves you. Yes, tell me what moves you. Oh, is it a fragrance? Then I'll pour my oil out. Is it a life laid down? Then here I give my vows. Is it a song I sing? Then here's every melody. Just tell me what moves you. Just tell me what moves you. Go and tell me what moves you. Tell me what moves you. And then let it arise like incense. My whole life is a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet. And every breath an offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, the worthy King of Kings, the worthy King of Kings. You're the worthy King of Kings, the worthy King of Kings. Your grace that flows like a river is washing over me. Oh, fount of heaven, love of Christ, overflow in me. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. In Christ, my Savior, you've rescued me. So take this life delivered, a vessel of your love. I am wholly now devoted to see your kingdom come. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You set me free.
Yes, thank you, Jesus. You set me free in Christ my Savior. You've rescued me.
You've given me life, and you've opened my eyes. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You've entered my heart, and you've set me apart. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Yes, you. So thank you, Jesus. You set me free. In Christ my Savior, you've rescued me. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Oh, in Christ the Savior, Christ my Savior. You've rescued me.
Yes, Jesus, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you've rescued us. We thank you that you've set us free. We thank you that we're free, indeed because of what you've done, Jesus. But we don't just stop at thank you, Lord. We desire to be people who would pour out their hearts to you, just like we talked about last week, just like we've been talking about in this sermon series. We would pour our hearts out to you, not just in worship, not just in song, not that we would just get touchy and feely when the music turns on or when the lights dim down, but it would be a life lived out in obedience, that nothing amazing that happens would be too amazing to come and worship you, that it wouldn't get our love, that you would get all of our love and devotion, that everything else would just be overflow. Jesus, we love you. We seriously love you, Jesus. And would that be lived out in our lives? And all of these practical things that we have talked about over the past month or month and a half or 2 months, Lord, you know how long. Would we live those things out? Would we be your obedient people that desire to see you and that would lead us to be pure in heart? Lord, that we would be poor in spirit, recognizing that we're nothing without you, that we're nothing apart from you. Apart from you, we can do nothing. Jesus, we love you, and we thank you, because it's only in you, and it's only with an adequate view of you that we can even walk around through this life with our eyes open, with our heart truly beating because you're there. You're the one who's given us life. You're the breath that is in our lungs, Lord. So would every word, would every heartbeat, would every action, our hands, our feet, everything that we do, would it be for you? In view of your mercies, God, would we offer up our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to you? For that is our true and proper worship. You want worshipers in spirit and truth. You don't just want a song. It's so much more than a song, or getting up early on Sunday, or coming to church. You want people that would come to you every second of every day, that we would do life as we're at your feet, being led by your spirit. Would you lead us and guide us so that we could have good works that the world may see, that they would glorify you. You're the main character of our life. It's not us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We love you in this place, and we pray for Pastor Jon as he comes up and gives the message that you have for us this morning. Would it not meet closed ears or closed hearts or closed eyes? But would we ask, as always, that you would search us and know us, God, and you would tell us if there be any grievous way in us. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Thank you, worship team. Good morning and welcome. As we were singing, "We're Getting Ready," I got a question for you. While we're flipping, go ahead and flip to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, right? Because our Lord is going to return. And in this meantime, we're called to be getting ready. We're called to be becoming sanctified. We're called to becoming more like Christ, right? Becoming more holy and living out this life. Right? And so the challenge is that we sing that song that we're getting ready. And the question is are we truly getting ready? Are we taking effort to become ready for his return? Right? Are we living in light of the reality that there is a day coming, and it could be this morning, we don't know, right, that he returns? And so here's the question, right? When we say we're getting ready, if Jesus were to walk down the aisle this morning, would there be things that we would be like, no, I need to deal with some things first? Right? Some things that maybe we'd be ashamed of in our lives that we haven't gotten dealt with, right, or that we haven't owned or haven't confessed or haven't repented of, and we're like, no, I thought I had more time. Right, if that's the case, if there is things that come to mind, that if Jesus was walking down the aisle this morning and he'd be like, just give me 5 more minutes, then take the 5 minutes right now and do that. Right, what are we waiting for? Right, because he could happen that fast. And I think we need to live with that constant reality, because that's what we're talking about when we sing that song, "We're Getting Ready." We're actually preparing ourselves for the return of Christ. And as we were singing that song, the Holy Spirit kind of brought back 2 Peter chapter 3. And it talks all about the day of the Lord and how the day of the Lord will come. And you come down into verse 8, "But do not overlook this fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you." And thank goodness that he is, right? He's patient towards you, not wishing that any would perish, but that all would come to repentance. "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. And then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done in it will be exposed." Right? That's what's happening. That's what's going to happen someday. And we don't know what that day is. Right? And then we come down into verse 11, and this is the challenge. "Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness?" What kind of people ought we be? Knowing that that day is coming, how should we be living? Verse 12, "Waiting for and hastening in the coming day of the God, which because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt away as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for the new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since we are waiting for these, right, be diligent to be found in him without spot or blemish and at peace. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul, who also wrote to you according to the wisdom given to him, right? But this is all talking about the fact that if we're living in view of that, we should be living holy and upright and godly lives today. And that's a challenge, right? But it's a reality of something we need to be living out. And so with that in mind, right, 6 to 10-year-olds, I always miss it because I get into the thing and it's like, 6 to 10-year-olds, you're already released to go to class through this morning, it's in the conference room to the right, so if you're a guest and you have a 6 to 10-year-old, out the doors and to the right, there's a conference room there. They'd be more than willing to have your kids there and be able to teach and pour into them as well. But just keep that in mind, right? Are you truly getting ready? We sing the song, but is that real? Is that your heart's intent, right, that you want to be holy and blameless and righteous before the King? And so a couple quick announcements before we get into the message. That's just kind of an intro, kind of a side note, if you will. Today, following service, is an annual meeting. There's a board meeting here afterwards, so probably, I don't know, we'll see 20 minutes or so after service, probably we'll all gather back in here, those who are interested, and we'll go ahead and go through the annual meeting, where we were at in 2023, where we feel the Lord is leading us in 2024. All are welcome and encouraged to attend, but if you're not, the doors will end up getting closed. You're welcome to stay and visit and fellowship out in the coffee area, and we'll continue to have the meeting here afterwards. So then potluck Sunday next weekend, and then you'll notice this insert in your bulletin. It's from Life Outreach Center, our local crisis pregnancy center, right? Today is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And it's an annual thing where it brings us back to the reality of the importance of life and the fact that God ordained life, and that in our country and around the world, right, abortion is becoming huge. Right? It's been huge for a long time, but it's a huge issue, right? And so we have the Life Outreach Center in our local community, where it's one of our missions that we support as a church, right, to combat that and to equip people to be able to keep their little ones and to understand the importance of life, right? And so it's just a quick reminder to us, right, to be able to sit down and to be able to pray over that reality, that there is a lot of people, right, in this world that are struggling with those types of decisions. And how do we pray for them, and how do we help them to have the Lord come in and engage them in that moment and to fight for life instead of just conceding to the fact that, you know, it's just easier to let that life go. Not true, right? Every life is valuable. Every life is important. Every life is given by the Lord. And so how do we value that and partner with them down that road? So I encourage you, right, to keep that in prayer. Just a reminder to pray for the unborn and pray for those fathers and mothers that are maybe struggling with those types of decisions, and that they would be able to find a place where they can gather the support that they need to continue to endure. So those are the announcements for this morning. We're in our series on Sermon on the Mount. Obviously, the question for you up there on my thing, my announcement, how is your yes? If you've been following with us, this is, again, the joy of expository preaching for yourself, is that you get to know where we're headed. Right? There's not a surprise here, right? If you've been with us for the last few months here, you realize that we're in the Sermon on the Mount, and we're coming to the spot about where Jesus talks about oaths. He talks about our yeses being yeses and our noes being noes, and right, being able to live in this place of integrity and honesty and truthfulness in the way that we interact with one another, right? And it is crucial to our relationships. I think every one of us knows that. And so, quick question, right? How important, right, for you to examine, how important is trust to you in your relationships? You don't have to answer that to me, right? But I encourage you to sit down and think about that for a minute, because in your relationships, how important is trust? How important is it that your husband, wife, right, the most intimate relationship there is, right? How important is that you can trust your husband and your wife? Right, close friends, coworkers, neighbors, how important it is it to you that you can trust them, that what they say, they mean? And how much damage does it do when we realize that they're not being trustworthy? When they're speaking false, when they're trying to deceive or twist, right, it damages and it breaks relationships pretty quickly. And then the hard part is that it damages that relationship. And this is why it's so important, this integrity is important in the Christian church, and where Jesus is going to drive at this here the rest of this morning, is the fact that because of the integrity, right, when we damage one relationship, if we're not careful, it starts to taint all relationships. Because once we get burned, we start to get this thing in the back of our mind, if we're not careful, that goes, if that person lied to me, what's the stops you from lying to me? What's hindering you from speaking truthful to me? Can I really trust you? I thought I could trust people, my husband, my wife, my kids, my parents, whatever it might be, the closest relationship. I thought I could trust people, and they broke it. And I don't even know you. Can I trust you? And so it starts to hinder relationships on a larger scale, because my guess is that, like I said, trust is really important. And it's really important to our witness of Christ as well, right? Acts 1:8, right? We're his witnesses to the world, right? And so if we're unreliable in our word, right, if we're not trustworthy, why should people believe the word that we pass along to them? Right, there's the challenge here again, right? There's an importance. Our integrity then ties back to our integrity and our ability to witness to the truth of Jesus Christ. Do they really believe what they say? Or is it just words? Are they things that we pass along and actually don't live out? And so a couple self-examination questions for yourself this morning in light of that. Are you reliable and trustworthy? Right? Don't have to answer to me, right? But answer to yourself, right? Answer to the Lord, right? Are you reliable or trustworthy, right? Be honest with that. Because right? If we're not honest about it, if we know there's areas of our lives where we're not reliable and trustworthy, and we're like, I'm good, who's that helping? And then tied to that question, when you make promises, do you make promises you cannot keep, or more importantly, don't intend to keep? Because right, that last portion, that do not intend to keep, right, is really what Jesus is going to drive at here this morning, because the Pharisees and Sadducees are making up oaths, promises, you know, convictions, saying I'm going to do these things, vows, but they never really intended to do them. They were making these oaths and these vows and these promises under a false pretense, knowing that that would give them an out. I don't really have to keep those promises that I make here. Personal promises and oaths aren't that important. It's okay. God doesn't hold you accountable when you break those things. And we're going to find out that that's not true. Jesus and the Father definitely keep us accountable to those things. Are we always perfect in those promises? Do things come up in life? 100%, right? We made a promise we're going to do something, and something else came along, something maybe way out of our control, right? And we go, now I'm stuck. What do? I made a promise to my brother, my sister, my spouse, whatever, but all these circumstances have changed, and you know, there's really just not a way I can get out of that. What do you do in those moments? Right? How do you respond when you're not able to keep your promise? Do you own it and go back and go, hey, right, some circumstances have changed. Right? Can we reset this? Right? Can we, you know, set a new date to get together? Can we make a different time to talk? Whatever it might be, right? There's some things have come up. Do you own that? Or do you just kind of ignore it and go, it's not that big of a deal? Because it is a big deal. When we say we're going to do something, we're supposed to follow through on those things when we make those kinds of promises. And in our portion this morning, right, Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, if you're not there yet, go ahead and go to Matthew 5, and we're in 33 through 37. Right, in our portion for this morning, right, Jesus is talking about the importance of honesty and integrity. So let's go ahead and read that, Matthew chapter 5, verses 33 through 37. It says this, again, right, we're in this series of antithesis, right, this Jesus of confronting the false teachings of the Pharisees and the scribes. Versus what the true meaning of the law is, right? That's what we want to keep us in mind here, right? So just one more of those that Jesus is going, you've heard something. Let me tell you, that's not really true. That's not really the purpose. That's not really the depth of what I'm after. Right? They're after external righteousness. God, Jesus Christ, is after the internal heart righteousness. And that's what we're always going back to, and it's no different here. Again, verse 33, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn. But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Verse 37, let what you say be simply yes or no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. It comes from evil. Right? And so we're talking about oaths here. Jesus is confronting that. And when you think about an oath, biblically speaking, right? Let's make this clear up front. Oaths, biblically speaking, are when we're calling God into account. We're asking God to make an account for you and I. that what I'm saying is true. And if what I'm saying is true, he supports it. And I'm going to say at the same time in the making of that oath, if I am lying, if you're lying in that oath, you're calling God to judge you for it. Right, that's what an oath truly is. Right? We're calling God to be the judge in the situation, that what I'm saying is true, and if it's not true, judge me. And I don't know how many of us want to boldly make those kinds of statements before the Lord, right? If what I'm not saying is not true, do I really mean that I want God to judge me? That's what an oath does. It's saying, God, I want you to judge me. I don't care what anybody else does. When I call you as my witness, God, if I'm wrong, if I'm lying, take care of it with me. And I hope you understand that God will probably work through something to help you deal with that, correct? Probably not going to leave a lie unaddressed. He's going to actually bring you to face that head on at some point. Maybe not immediately, but going forward. So when you take an oath, you're actually bringing God into the mix. So verse 33, again, you've heard that it was said to people long ago, do not break your oath, but keep the oath you have made to the Lord. Right, this is a summary of multiple Old Testament verses. Right, that's the first thing we need to understand. Right, if you were to go and you were to look for that verse in the Old Testament, not going to find it. Right, Jesus has basically taken a summary of Old Testament verses and kind of mashing them all together to get the concept, to get the idea of what's being spoken here. First one is found in Leviticus, so keep your finger here in Matthew. We're going to come back. Go back to the book of Leviticus, Leviticus chapter 19. All under the portion of loving your neighbor as yourself, right? This is talking about how we're supposed to interact on the horizontal platform. Jesus is dealing with the same thing in the Sermon on the Mount. He's like, Pharisees and scribes, you're twisting what relationships are supposed to look like, right? What's healthy relationships in view of the Lord? Leviticus 19, verse 12. You shall not swear by my name falsely, and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord, right? You shall not swear by my name falsely. Right, meaning that I'm swearing by your name that this is true when you have no intentions of it being true. Right, you're calling his name into play to try to give yourself some credibility. Right, this is really that, it's really true, and you're hoping that the person will buy it. And God's like, don't do that. Don't bring that into the mix. And then the next one is found in Numbers chapter 30, verse 2. Numbers chapter 30. Verse 2. There's some pages flipping still, so wait for you to get there. Right, men and vows. Moses spoke to the head of the tribes of the people of Israel, saying, this is what the Lord has commanded. Verse 2. If a man vows a vow to the Lord, or swears an oath to bind himself by a pledge, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeds of his mouth. If you make a vow to the Lord, then you're going to keep it. End of story. No questions asked, right? A vow to the Lord is not something that you take lightly. And that's what Jesus is bringing this all back into, right? So the Old Testament says that, and if we make an oath to God, we better intend to keep it. Right? We better intend to keep it. And so the Pharisees and the scribes, when you go back to Matthew chapter 5, you've heard that it was said, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn. Sounds very biblical, sounds very true, and it is, right? That in itself isn't wrong. If you make a vow to the Lord, keep it. Good. The problem is, as we see here, and as we'll continue through Matthew 5, is the fact that the scribes and the Pharisees were focusing in on those simple words of the Lord. If you brought the Lord into the mix, guilty. If you make an oath or a vow under anything else, it's okay. God's okay with that. Those can be broken. Right? They focused on those simple little words of the Lord, and so they were looking for loopholes, no different than they did with murder, no different than they did with adultery, no different than they did with divorce. Right? The scribes and the Pharisees were constantly looking for the loopholes. Here's what's said, but how can we lessen that? How can we lower the bar, if you will, and make it easy for us to be and to look righteous? What's the lowest common denominator? What's the loophole I can find? And they had come to the loophole of going, if I don't make a vow to the Lord, we can get out of it. Promise by anything else you want. How many of us look for loopholes at times, right? We're looking for loopholes in different situations. Well, did I really? That isn't really what I meant. That isn't really what I said. We're looking for loopholes in relationships and, you know, to get out of maybe some of the things maybe we've promised. And what we're going to find is, as Jesus goes, there is no loopholes because God witnesses everything. God hears every word that comes out of our mouth. And so just because you didn't say, I vow in the Lord's name, God goes, you're my followers, thus everything you say is under my covering and my direction. Starting to see the level of righteousness that's required compared to what the Pharisees and the Sadducees want? Jesus goes, there's no out here. Everything you say is supposed to be true, whether you vow or not. Pharisees weren't living their life that way. And so there's nothing wrong with the teaching of keeping your vows, but it's a matter of which it is you go down, right? Breaking your oath. Here's the issue in our day, right? They're teaching people this truth, right? But if you give people an inch, how far will they go? A mile, right? Right? If you give them an inch, they're going to find every loophole that's out there, right? Because that's our own fleshly nature coming into play. Our flesh wants what's easy. And Jesus is going, no, that's not what I'm here for. That's not what the purpose and the intent of that was. But I want you to yield to me. And so they make it sound like I'm making an oath to the Lord, as we'll see in Matthew 5:33, right? Make an oath to heaven or, you know, to earth or to Jerusalem. Those all sound very holy and righteous and religious. But they made sure that they didn't include the Lord. I'll make a vow by heaven. Great. Right? Who's this heavens? Right? The heavens is the Lord's, right? As we'll see here in a minute, right? And so they deliberately kept out that simple little statement of the Lord, because what they're really trying to do is, how can I trick you to believing me that what I'm saying is real? Parents, how many times have you had little kids, right? And you know they're lying, and they're trying everything they can to, like, no, it's not. I mean it. It's really. I promise. Do we believe them? Probably not, right? Some cases we do, but they're trying everything under the sun to get mom and dad to believe that they're being truthful. Mom and dad are going, okay, go ahead, right? And then, you know, when I think about it with our kids, right, it's like, you're just digging your hole deeper. Right? I already know you're lying to me, but go ahead, keep digging. How far do you want to go with this? Right? I think God does the same thing with us. He's like, if you want to keep making vows, go ahead, but you're just digging the hole deeper. I know what the true intentions of your heart was. The intentions of your oath was to get out of something, to make it look good. And that's not the intention of an oath. That's not the purpose of an oath. It's not about how we can trick people into believing I'm telling the truth. Right? It's actually called to live and to attest to the truth. And so back to Matthew chapter 5, verse 34 and through 36. Right? Here's Jesus' response. Hey, what does Jesus say about this twisting of the truth a little bit? Verse 34, but I say to you, do not take an oath at all. Right? Don't have any oaths. And there is some, as we'll talk about here, closer to the end of today's message, right? There is truly whole denominations, right? Whole groups of believers that take that literally, and they won't even take an oath in the court of law. Right? They take that so literally that Jesus said, "Don't take any oaths." So they're not going to take an oath in the court of law. They won't take vows at a marriage ceremony because Jesus said, "Don't take any oaths." Period. And I think we're missing the point, because as we'll see as we go through the Old Testament, right, God took oaths. God made oaths. Paul took oaths. Jesus testified under oath. So it obviously isn't saying that all oaths are bad, that all oaths are wrong, right? But that's where some have taken this, right, of not swearing at all. But he's talking about the manipulation thereof, right? And so a couple reasons why this is what, you know, the importance of our oaths. One reason is because it actually weakens the truth. Your oath weakens truth. I don't know if you've ever thought about that. But the fact that I have to say, I promise, opens up the doorway that there might be a lie. Right? If I always spoke the truth, if everybody in this room always spoke the truth, would we ever have to say, I promise I'm telling you the truth? Right? We would never have to. The fact that we have to take an oath or make a promise to try to get somebody to believe that what I'm saying is true is because there is lies. And maybe, just maybe, right, we're guilty of those things in relationships. And so thus, because I know that I have lied or said things that were untrue to try to deceive, right, then I have to go, I promise you. Right? I promise you, this time I'm speaking truthful. And that's your listener stuck going, do I believe him this time? He's calling on the Lord to be that he says truthful, so I guess maybe I'll believe him this time. There's the purpose of an oath, but oaths actually weaken the truth. Right? The only reason why oaths exist is because lies exist. Dietrich Bonhoeffer puts it this way: the Old Testament condemned the lie by the use of an oath. Right? Condemned the lie by the use of an oath. But Jesus destroys the lie by forbidding oaths altogether. And Jesus is like, don't take oaths. There's not really a need for it. Why? Because your yes should be yes. Your no should be no. It should be that simple. Everything that comes out of our mouth should be truth. Is that the case? Have you ever stretched it a little bit? Fishing stories, right? Oh, it's not a big deal. Maybe it is a big deal. It might not be a big deal here, right? We get it, right? It's not, you know, people just, you know, it's okay. It's just a little white lie. There's no such thing in God's kingdom, right? One commentator that I was listening to goes, the littlest of white lies is black, right? There is no little white lies in God's kingdom, right? Your yes should be yes. Your no should be no. There should be integrity. There should be truthfulness in your speech. And so if you're deliberately deceiving somebody, you're knocking contrary to the kingdom. There's the level of righteousness that God is asking us to, that Jesus is pointing us to, that we're supposed to be holy. Any little bit underneath there, right, would disqualify us apart from Christ. And so when I think about it, I bring us back to the truth of the gospel, right, bring us back to Christ, right? The fact of the matter is that when I do fall short, and when you fall short, thankfully, we have Christ. He is the true source of our righteousness. It isn't based off of you and me performing perfectly, even though that's what we're called to. We're called to that level of holiness. And so it's not an excuse not to, but it's a motivation to make every effort to walk down that path. So it weakens the truth. And the next point is we must remember that God always is witness to everything. And I think that's the whole crux of this teaching. Right, no matter what's going on, no matter if you sit in a corner, whether it's just you and somebody else, whether it's in front of everybody, God is witnessing it all. Everything you speak, right? Scripture says elsewhere, right? We'll give account for every idle word. Well, nobody was around. Well, okay. So that makes it okay. I don't think it does make it okay. Right? God heard those words. God is everywhere, right? He's omnipresent. He's in every situation, and if he's indwelling you, he heard the words that came out of your mouth. Were they truthful or not? And so there's where we come into this play, right? Jesus brings it back, and he exposes the real ways that the Pharisees tried to manipulate it. Look at verse 34b through 36. Don't take an oath, and he goes, by heaven, for it is the throne of God, by earth, for it is the footstool, for Jerusalem is the city of the great king. And don't take an oath by your head either, for you cannot make it one hair white or black. Keep your finger here, right? This is, again, brought up again in Jesus' teaching with the Pharisees. Keep your finger in Matthew 5, slide to Matthew 23. Right? Pharisees started twisting this a little bit farther. Right? How can we make oaths? What can we swear by? Matthew 23. Starting in verse 16, part of the seven woes. Verse 16, woe to you blind guides who say, if anyone swears by the temple, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gold in the temple, he's bound by his oath. See how they started to manipulate this? They're like, there's certain things you can do and make oaths and it's not a big deal. But if you make an oath by this thing, it is a big deal. And so now there's all these twists and turns and manipulations of the rules and going, Jesus is like, what are you doing? And he says that as such, right? Verse 17, you blind fools, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that has made the gold sacred? And you say, if anyone swears by the altar, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gift that is on the altar, he's bound by his oath. You blind men, which is greater, the gift of the altar, the gift or the altar that makes the gift sacred? So whoever swears by the altar swears by it and everything on it. And whoever swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And whoever swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. Very similar. Basically, he's going, the temple's holy, right, because it's the Lord's. And so if you're going to swear that's okay, but swearing by the gold in it isn't, you're just twisting it. You're trying to find out. One rabbi that I came across that they talked about is the fact that in the reality, he goes, if you prayed, how was it? You prayed the oath under Jerusalem, it was fine. But if you turned and prayed towards Jerusalem, it was wrong. What's the difference? Now you can pray, but you can take an oath by Jerusalem all you want as long as you're not praying towards it. How minute and how much, you know, finite things are we trying to twist it by? Also, you can deceive people. That's really the heart's drive behind it. I'm trying to deceive people to think that I'm telling them the truth. And it's not true. Instead of swearing by anything, right, don't swear anything at all. Right? Yes, it sounds good, but is that the purpose? Right? Check the heart. You're simply trying to deceive people? If you are, then you're in the wrong spot. You know, you're going down the wrong path. And so what about people who swear by their head? Let me ask a question. Does any of us have a control over our life? Right? Can we turn our hair black or white, full or bald? Right? We have no control over those things. And yet I'm going to swear by them as if I do. I have no control over that. So why am I swearing by that? As if I could do something about it, as if you could do something about it. And that's Jesus' point. He goes, the body, right, whether you live or die, that's up to God. Whether your hair is black or white, that's up to God. So don't swear by that. You can do nothing different. Because if you're swearing by your body, right, that my hair is black or white, by my head, that it's true, then what are you telling them? If you're telling them a lie, do you want them to take your head off? I don't know. What is your importance of saying that? My guess, that isn't what you mean. Right? Kids in our day, or my day maybe. Maybe I should put it better, my day. I don't know if it is a popular thing today. Right? There was a saying similar, right? Cross my heart, hope to die, poke a needle in my eye, right? I'm going to tell you, I said that as a kid. I never wanted you to do any of that to me. Right? I didn't, right? I'm not sitting there going, if I'm lying to you, please poke me. I never meant that. But it sounded really good. That's how serious I was about it, right? I promise you, this is true. But if it's false, please don't jab me there. It was just a way to try to reinforce it. What is the means that you use maybe to reinforce something that you mean? Maybe we all have something different. What's your go-to that you're trying to evoke this reality that what you're saying is really truthful? You want people to buy it. But maybe it's not that. Right? Maybe it's something else, right? I swear to God. Ever heard that statement? Probably have. Right? Those are the types of oaths that we're talking here. And Jesus says, don't do those. Don't do them. Right? You can't swear by your head. You don't have any control over it. And so the whole bottom line of this whole thing, right, is the Pharisees are trying to play the system. The righteousness of God's kingdom doesn't look to play the system. Right? Are we trying to play the system? Sometimes, probably. Right? I'm down this path, and a lot of times what happens is because once we started with a little white lie, and then all of a sudden maybe that gets caught or somebody gets wise to it, we go, I don't know if I want to own that. So then we try to spin something else, and then we try to spin something else, and the web just gets deeper and wider and stronger in its hold on us. And that's a scary spot to be, right, when we start to go down that path of playing the game, because eventually the game's going to catch up to us, and Jesus' whole point is, there is no game. because the Father hears all of it. He's a witness to everything. And so then Jesus brings us to verse 37. He goes, it's really simple. And listening to his, you know, speaking to his listeners, speaking to you and I, it's really, really simple. Right? Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Be truthful in everything you say. Does that mean everything, Pastor? Yes, everything. Right? Your yes should be yes. Well, I was just kidding. No. Right? Not true. Right? If that's not truth, then you shouldn't say it. Whether you were kidding or not. Because here's the reality, right? When we start to speak truthful, when we start to interact in relationships, right? When we speak something out, usually the only time we say we were just kidding is when we got caught. That isn't really what I meant. Anybody been able to give those words back that somebody has spoken over you that were death to your life? Just kidding, take the hurt away? My guess is no. Right? When somebody spoke something that was untruthful, right, and they wounded, and they came back and said, well, I was just kidding. It didn't take the pain away. Right, so we're supposed to be speaking truthful all the time. Is that hard? Yes. Impossible in our flesh. Right? We need the Holy Spirit to empower us to be able to check our words all the time. So if you need to add something to your words to make them more credible, right, it throws doubt on everything else you say. Right? That when I read that here this week, I'm like, wait a minute. It's kind of true. If I've got to sit here and say, right, I want to be credible in this situation, then that person should be able to look back and go, well, then what about that one? Did you mean what you said then? Because you didn't ask me to swear an oath then. You didn't like build it up like it's truthful. So were you speaking truth then? I was like, it's kind of true. Right? I shouldn't have to pile these things on to be credible. Another way to look at it, right? If another person asks you, do you promise? Ever been that? Maybe not as adults, right? We don't maybe necessarily put those requirements on us as adults, but kids definitely do. Do you promise? Why do they have to ask that in there? Right? To me, it just shows the fact that maybe you haven't been faithful to your word in the past. Right? Nobody should have to ask that if you haven't blown it at some point. Right? And maybe not you have blown it in that specific situation, but their experience has been that when people tell me something, I can't trust them. And so they have this broken relationship mindset with people going, I can't trust you, so I'm going to ask you, do you promise that you're going to do it? And then that makes me at least, okay, right? I'll go with you, or I'll do it, or I'll believe you. But the fact that we have to ask that says chances are we've probably broken it at some point. And I would encourage you in your own relationships intimately, right? If you've ever had people, right, whether it's friends, neighbors, coworkers, kids, spouses, right? Do you promise? If they got to ask it, check yourself because chances are you've broken that. Right? And if you have, then own it. Right? I know that I've damaged trust. How can I build that trust with you again? Will you allow me to build trust with you down that path again? I know that I lied to you. I know that I deceived you. Right? It wasn't correct. Will you forgive me for deceiving you? Right? How can I build that trust? Will you open up doorways? Right? I promise to speak truthful to you from here on out. Right? There's huge benefits to speaking truthful all the time. But it's very hard to go down that road. So your yes should be yes, and your no, say no. So if you say you're going to do something, what does that mean? Do it. So if we tell our kids' parents that we're going to do something, do it. Right? If we say we're not going to do something, don't do it. Right, is that hard when it comes to parenting at times? 100%. Oh, but we want to. I already told you no. I'm not changing that mindset. It's no. Right? And again, right, if as parents, and I'll take this blame back to myself, right? As a husband, as a father, as somebody who was a workaholic, right? And then there was promises made, and all of a sudden work comes up to play, right, guys? And you go, let's see, I know I told my kids I was going to do that, but work is, you know, needs me to stay late, so I'm just going to stay late. Kids will understand. No big deal. It's a big deal. Right? It's a big deal. Right? Our kids take that and they go, okay, so Dad said he was going to do it here. Right? And he said his word was good and I trust him. And now God, you know, maybe Dad is bringing in something more, or he's bringing in something spiritual, and he's saying, I'm supposed to trust God, but does he mean that there? Can I trust him in that statement? It's huge in relationships, and I can't express it enough on the parenting-child relationship. It starts to get ingrained at a young age. Right? Kids start to realize, can I trust people? And their primary means of being able to trust people comes from mom and dad holding truth to their word and saying yes is yes and your no is no and living down that path. Right? Be a person of your word. Right? Be a person of integrity. Right? Keep it even when it hurts. Right? This is the importance of thinking about it before you make a commitment. Right? Consider the cost. Count it up. Right? Am I really willing to do this? Right? One commentator says, right, you should actually consider, right, what the other possible twists might be before you make a commitment. Right? So if this comes up, if I commit here and this happens, what's my response going to be? If this could possibly happen, is that going to change my point of view? Is that going to change my word? Right? And start to think through some of those scenarios. Am I willing to stick to it? Regardless of what comes up. Come what may, if it's difficult, I'm still going to hold to it. And if I'm not going to hold to it, then that means I have to communicate to that person that I've changed my mind. Right? I need to break the promise because of X. I need to own it and actually deal with it. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. Right? Who's the father of lies? Satan. Right? Pretty simple. Scripture says it, right? He's the father of lies. Right? No questions asked. Right? When he lies when he speaks, he speaks his own native tongue, right? He's the liar and the father of lies, right? So let's make this really, 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 really simple, right? When we speak the truth, who do we follow? Jesus. When we choose to lie, who are we following? Right? So maybe next time when we sit there and we're thinking about the fact that, well, you know, maybe I'm just going to twist the truth a little bit. Step back and remind ourselves, I'm now following the father of lies. I'm no longer following Christ in that moment. We are making an intentional choice, an intentional decision to say that I'm going to align myself with the enemy of truth. And when you put it that way, it's like, well, what am I doing? I say I'm a son of the king. I say I'm a daughter of truth. Right? He's my all. But in this moment, I'm going to choose to follow him. Where does that lead? What does the enemy come to do according to Scripture? Kill, steal, destroy. Right? There is nothing good that's going to come out of us choosing to follow the father of lies. Zero. Absolutely nothing. All that is going to lead to is destruction. And maybe as many of us have stories that we can share, right? Battle stories that we can share of the fact of the destruction that has taken place in relationships because of lies. Because of half-truths. Half-truth is a whole lie. Right? If we're deliberately holding back something, we're lying to somebody. If we're speaking just part of it because we know that's acceptable, but if they heard the whole story, they wouldn't agree with me, we're lying. We're not being truthful. We don't have integrity. And that's a challenge back to us. This is the reality of what Jesus is confronting here. As a whole, he goes, guys, Pharisees, scribes, you know what? You're missing the point. Right? The righteousness that is required in my kingdom is far beyond that because you're supposed to be righteous in all circumstances. You're to never speak anything untruthful. Everything is supposed to come out of your mouth is supposed to be truthful. Does that mean that there isn't going to be times we fall short? No, it is, right? We all have experienced that. We've made it, you know, we've lied in the situations. Deal with it. Don't excuse it. Well, anybody would have done that. Okay. Maybe in the flesh we would have, but that doesn't make it right. Right? God is testifying to all of it. And then we have to make a decision who it is we're going to follow, right? Be a person of integrity that nobody would doubt you. And it would be awesome to be able to sit and think about it, right? As a body of believers, as we grow and mature in these character traits, right? And start to live these things out, that when somebody said something to us, it wouldn't come into the back of our mind going, are they really telling me the truth? Right? We would just take it and go, it's truth. I believe them. Right? No questions asked. And I believe they're speaking truthful because there's an integrity to their character that says that's what they are. That's who they are. Right? And it should be that way in our families, right? Parents, husbands, wives, parents, the kids. There should be an integrity. Our kids shouldn't question. Shouldn't have to. Right? They know that if mom or dad say something, it's truthful. There's no need to deceive them. Right? And so help them to build that reality and that integrity in their own lives. As I said at the beginning, right, Jesus, there is whole denominations that take his thing there, don't make any oaths, to be the fact that everything is gone, right, not even in certain circumstances. It is not forbidden by Scripture. Oaths aren't forbidden, right? So if you want to take an oath in certain circumstances, right, marriage vows, right? We're vowing to each other. We're taking an oath to commit our lives to one another before the Father, right? Those vows are perfectly fine. And it isn't that Jesus is going, don't do them. The whole point of Jesus' argument here about oaths is the fact, don't take an oath to cover up a lie. Right? Don't take oaths to try to make yourself look good. Right? If you're going to take an oath, mean your oath. Right? Live that thing out. And you could go to Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 20. You don't need to flip there, but Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 20. Or Hebrews chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. And then in those verses, you'll see that God permits and takes oaths himself. Right? God takes oaths. Right? In Hebrews 6:17, it says, because God wanted to make the unchanging nature of his purpose very clear to the heirs of what was promised, he confirmed it with an oath. Right? God confirms oaths, or the Lord confirms oaths with Abraham in the Old Testament. But he takes an oath. And so it's not like oaths are bad. If all oaths were outlawed and all oaths were evil, right, then God wouldn't have taken them in the Old Testament. He does. So obviously that's not the purpose of Jesus' teaching here. You could look at Jesus' life himself. If you're still in Matthew, go over to chapter 26. Right? Jesus swears under oath, if you will. He gives testimony. He's remained silent for most of this whole story, right, of his plot and, you know, being arrested and all these things. Jesus is before the high council, Matthew 26. Verse 62, and the high priest stood up and said, have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you? Verse 63, but Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, I adjure you by the living God, right? Jesus, I'm putting you under oath that what you're going to tell me is true. And I'm going to call you to a higher authority, right? I'm going to call you to put yourself under subjection to the Father, right? To God as a whole, right? I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you're the Christ, the Son of God. Verse 64, Jesus said to him, you have said so, right? He confirms, right? He doesn't come out and say, I am, he says, what you have said is true, right? He confirms that. He affirms what the high priest is saying, I am the Son of God. Did Jesus have a problem taking that oath? No. Right? Should Jesus have not taken the oath? He just said no oath. No. Right? Because he's not trying to deceive anybody. He's simply affirming the truth of what's been said. And then the Apostle Paul calls God as his witness as well. Right? And so God takes oaths. Jesus testifies under oath. And then you go back to Paul, and Paul goes, I call God as my witness in Romans chapter 1, verse 9. But he calls God as his witness. Right? Because again, there's no intention to deceive. What Jesus is after is, like, if you're truthful, you're truthful. The oath can accentuate that. But if you're taking the oath to deceive, don't do it. And that's unfortunately so often what we do, right? I swear to God, this is real. I mean it. Did we really? I had no intention of doing it, but I didn't want to hurt their feelings, so I promised them something. It's fine. It's not fine. It's something that needs to be dealt with and processed. Scholar Charles Quarles sums it up pretty neatly in his commentary on the Sermon on the Mount. It says this: in summary, Jesus prohibited the use of misleading oaths, but he did not intend to prohibit the use of all oaths in court, marital vows, oaths of office, and the use of other oaths on solemn occasions to emphasize one's truthfulness are both in line with biblical teaching and Christian practice. Right, there is a place for oaths in our Christian life. Right? Walk in those things, but if you're trying to mislead, don't. So how can we live this out? Three things as we come to a close. How do we live this out? Flip with me to Proverbs chapter 12. And there's a verse tied to each of these, Proverbs 12. First one is this, right? Be truthful in your speech. Right? Be truthful. No lying, no exaggerating, no distorting, no shading the truth. Right? Be truthful. Just say what it is, right? Call a spade, right? Live it out. Be truthful down the path. Right? Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22. I'll let you read it with your own eyes for a minute. Kind of ties back to what we just said about following the father of lies. Right? Proverbs 12, 22. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Right? How convicting is that, right? Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Right? So the next time that I speak a half-truth, white lie, whatever, right, I'm an abomination. The things coming off of my lips are an abomination to the Lord. He's like, what are you doing? And I detest those things. But look at the second half of that verse. But those who act faithfully are his delight. Those who live truthfully bring delight to the Lord. Right? Which side do we want to be on there? I think it's pretty clear, right? As we're called to be truthful in our speech. And it's absolutely necessary for trust. Thomas Fuller says this way, if I speak what is false, I must answer for it. If truth, it will answer for me. But if I speak what is false, eventually somebody's going to find out. And I'm going to have to answer for that. But if I speak the truth, somebody's going to find out. They're going to go and do the research. They might dig in. They might ask somebody. And they're going to go, huh, you're speaking the truth. All right, good enough. Move on. Right? Or I'm going to have to answer for myself on the flip side. Right? So commit yourself to speaking truth at all times. Right? All times. Doesn't matter what the situation is. Right? Even if it's going to make you really, really uncomfortable, even though it might cause you some pain, speak truth. Right? You're going to get much farther ahead going that path than following the father of lies on the other path. Point number two, be careful what you promise. Flip to the book of Ecclesiastes. So go one book to the right. If you're in Proverbs, just flip one book to the right and go to Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Right, since we've already made clear that God is a witness to everything we speak, literally everything, right? There's not a word that he's not aware of that we're spoken, right? There's nothing that I go, okay, God, close your ears for a moment. I want to speak something different. He doesn't do that, right? Or I'm going to go in the corner, shut the door. He won't hear me there. He's going to hear it, right? He's going to witness all of it. And so the writer of Ecclesiastes says this in verse 2, do not be rash with your mouth, nor let your heart be hasty to utter a word before God. For God is in heaven, and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. Right? And then you slide down a little bit farther in verse 4. When you vow a vow to God, do not delay paying it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you owe. Verse 5, it is better that you should not vow than you should vow and not pay. But if you have no intentions of keeping a promise, don't make one. It'd be better that you don't make the promise. It'd be better that you don't destroy trust. It'd be better that you don't betray a brother or sister. Just don't say it. Right? But if you're going to make one, get ready to live it out. Because it would be far better for you to not make the vow. You know, it's like, it's okay, don't make a vow. Not an issue. And I can't promise you that. How many parents have told that to their kids? You promise? No, I can't promise you that. Maybe you've said it to your spouse, right? Well, you know, can you promise we're going to do this? I can't promise that to you right now. I want to. Right? But I don't know all the circumstances yet. I can't promise you that. That's healthier. Right? That's honest. That's truthful. I can't promise. I'm going to tell you now, right? If I were to ask you something, right? And I were to ask you to commit to something, to help with something or whatever, right? I'd rather you tell me, you know what? I don't know right now. Right? I'm not sure if my schedule will allow it. I can live with that. Right? But when you make a promise and you say, well, I'll do that next Friday, and then it doesn't happen, now it starts to become difficult. Right? Am I called to forgive? Yes, I can forgive that and I can move on and right, we can challenge and things happen. But just be truthful. You're okay to be truthful that, hey, I can't do something. I'd rather that. And I'm guessing all of us in this body would rather that if I'm being told something. Right? If I can't do it, be careful with that. Don't make a vow if you can't. And then the last one is be faithful in following through. This is a hard one. It's found in Psalm chapter 15. So go ahead and flip to the book of Psalms. Psalm 15. And we'll close with this. Psalm 15, starting in verse 1. Being faithful to follow through even when it hurts. Psalm 15, verse 1. O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell in your holy hill? He who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart, who does not slander with his tongue and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up reproach against a friend, in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but who honors those who fear the Lord, who swears to his own hurt and does not change, who does not put up all his money at interest and does not take the bribe against the innocent, he who does things will never be moved. Right? He who walks blameless and does right and speaks truth in his heart. Right? Be willing to follow through with what you say. If you say yes to somebody, do your utmost to follow through with that yes. If you say no to somebody, do your utmost to not do it. Right? And that can happen no different in our marriage relationships. I'm not working today. How many guys have said that? I'm not working today. Right? Not doing it. Phone call comes in, hey, I need you at work. I told my spouse I wasn't working today. I told my kids I wasn't working today. Ah, you know what? They really need me, so I'm going to go to work. Right? Does that mean you can't go to work? No, right? You could go, okay, look, there's a situation, right? You could sit down with your spouse, you could sit down with your kids, you could go, hey, right, can we take a rain check on this? Right, I really need to do something. Something has came up. Can I change the plan? That's doable, right? But don't just flip the other side and go, I'm out. What I promise them doesn't matter. Be careful that you're willing to follow through on what you promise, and even when it hurts. Right? Be people of truth. Be people of honor. Be people of integrity. As I said, when you fall short, own it. Confess it. Right? Confess it to the person. Confess it to the Lord. God, forgive me that I'm not a man of my word right now. Right? Please help me to control my tongue in the vows and the promises I make. Right? Live a life of integrity before people, because as we do that, the ability to have unity amongst the body of Christ goes up exponentially. Exponentially in my mind. Because now all of a sudden we don't have to question each other. We don't sit with a little bit of suspect or a little bit of questioning, a little bit like, right? Because maybe so many of us have been grown up in the world that way. It's not supposed to be that way in the body of Christ. Right? People of integrity, speak truthful in all moments. Right? Trusting in Him to lead us down that path. Let's go ahead and close out in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the truth of your word. I pray that each one of us here that has heard the truth of your word would be willing to examine our own hearts, that we too would desire to be people of truth. Lord, that as we look at the title of our message of how is our yes, Lord, that it wouldn't be a back and forth thing, that when we say yes to something, we actually mean it. Lord, that the words that come out of our mouth are truthful. We're not trying to deceive people. We're not intentionally lying to people. We're actually speaking the things that we mean and then doing those things out as much as we can. Holy Spirit, would you help us? Would you create that heart desire in us to be, to have that integrity and that purity of our words and our speech to one another? May we always be present of the reality that you hear everything that we're speaking and everything that we're saying. And so when we make a vow or a promise, right, you are called into that because we are your sons and your daughters and we're representing your kingdom. And you've called for those in your kingdom to not live deceitfully. You're empowering those in your kingdom to live upright and holy and godly lives. Father, would you help us? Holy Spirit, would you bring forth conviction when it happens? And in the moment, if we're tempted to speak a lie, would you bring forth conviction and going, check, don't do it. And may we yield to that conviction. May we trust your leading. And may we speak truth even when it hurts at times. May we hold to our promises even when it hurts at times. Nothing destroys relationships quicker than a lack of trust. And I know that from experience, and I know that from talking with many others in this body, that trust is a hard thing, that once it's broken, it's hard to get back. And it starts to ripple through other relationships, and it's not right, but it does. And so help us to build trust with one another. Help us to encourage one another to speak truth and to be gracious in those moments when we don't, right? But to confront it and to address it and to deal with it, that we would be increasingly so people of integrity, that when we take an oath, we mean it. Lead us and guide us down that path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.